Okay. So, does anybody want to summarize what we did last time? So last time I introduced you to Stan and the syntax of Stan. Specifically, what was like the data scenario that we encountered?
There was an IQ test.
Aha. Uh-huh. So we had a whole bunch of IQ scores. What sort of model? We actually had two different models that we used to do inference on that. What were the two models?
There was like the actual one from the data set, the generative model. Is that right?
Generative was based on the population, right? That was our sort of preconceived notion.
I guess here, let me show you. So, and today I'm going to just duplicate what was in the code from last time into a new day. Because I'm going to overwrite some of that stuff. So I've got that one sample folder, and we had two models, two dot Stan models. So I showed you some pictures that there were two like features of the model. There's the generative model part and the priors part. So maybe that's, I think, what you were thinking
about.
Yeah,
so what do you mean when you say generative model?
Just like the data were generated by something.
Okay.
Like, I actually happen to have the script that made that fake data right there, so I happen to know what that actual data generating model is. But whenever we have a model in Stan, I like to think about it as we're trying to figure out or express our best guess as to what what algorithm produced the data, even if it's an algorithm out in real life that actually does it.
So in one model, we said we knew the standard deviation, and the other model, we also guessed the credibility range from the standard deviation.
Gotcha.
In both models,
yeah.
We didn't know the population.
And what does that correspond to from your more conventional education in statistics? Those two models. Yeah, exactly. So one sample z-test and one sample t-test. So let's actually open those up. I'm going to open up this project. And we'll open up the analysis. So we started out by just showing that, yes, this is a one-column data set with a bunch of IQs. We visualized it quick to make sure that the idea of we saw that the data were generally Gaussian distributed with the expected kind of range that we would get from an IQ test, maybe shifted a little bit with respect to our expectation of a mean of 100 for an IQ, and indeed, we could actually look at what the mean of the data set is and the mean of the standard deviation. And 109 is a bit bigger than what we would expect for an IQ. The question is, should the observed sample with a mean of 109, how much should that change our belief about the distribution or the population from which the sample was obtained? If we were starting off with a prior that the mean IQ should be about 100 plus or minus some amount. So that's what our next little bit foray into Stan involved. This model, one sample, one. We said that, okay, we're going to take in that IQ data. We're going to do inference on the mean for the population. We express that prior to seeing the data, we have a peak credibility for the mean of the population at 100 and pretty wide falling off of that credibility curve on either side. So that sort of ranges plus or minus 30 seemed relatively credible. And then we said that our model, this is what I tend to call the generative part of the model, that is that here's the data and it's being expressed as a function, some sort of distribution on this side. where this distribution involves some unknown quantities we want to do inference on. So the first thing we did was we said, okay, let's assume we know the standard deviation of the population is 15, and just do inference on this mean. And this was that first model. We played around with different amounts of confidence in this, peaked at 100 prior, so I think we tried it down to 2. And it still shifted away from 100 as being the peak, but it shifted away to a differing degree. When we had it at 30, the posterior distribution on the population mean, that is the distribution reflecting what are reasonable values for us to now believe about the population mean. When it was at 30, that tended to peak right at where the sample mean was, kind of conveying that our prior wasn't that certain at 100 in the first place. So the distribution of belief shifted quite a bit towards what the sample actually said. When we reduced this value to a very small value, conveying that we had high certainty that the value, our peak credibility, should be centered right on 100 with very little credibility on values further away from 100, the distribution still shifted towards the actual sample mean of 109, but not nearly as much. So that was the one sample case. The one sample kind of assumed population standard deviation scenario akin to the Z-test. If we want to do inference not only on the mean for the population, but also on the variability of the population, we had this other model, this one sample 02, where we now have two parameters we're doing inference on. The mean, as before, and now the standard deviation. And I introduced this little bit here where you have to tell the model that standard deviations can only be positive. So you express that constraint on the standard deviation. Having added a new variable on which we're uncertain, we express our prior beliefs about that variable. Now, had you guys use a normal distribution centered on 15, which is about what we'd sort of expect we'd probably want to have a peak belief at 15, but tapering off on either side with the magnitude of about 5. I think I drew it by hand, but I want to show you guys how you actually would draw or get R to show you this. So I'm going to make just a new script here. And we're going to use the curve function because it's quick. The curve function will actually draw something as a plot in the base graphics that I haven't really showed you much about. It's going to take multiple arguments, so I'm going to put them on separate lines. And if we want to look at the curve for a normal distribution, it's the dnorm function that we want to use. Let's see, curve. I'm going to put question mark curve. EXPR is the name of that first argument. So we're going to pass something. We're going to pass it dnorm as the argument for the EXPR argument. We want to tell it like what range of values to draw. So we have to say from. And if we think this, let's see, and we're going to do normal 15 and 5. So let's go from 0 and 2 equals 15. Or no, let's go up to 30. And the last thing I have to do, I actually have to, if I want to express a normal distribution with 15 and 5, I need to give dnorm some argument values. So let me actually just double check. Oh, there is a dot, dot, dot there. So this dot, dot, dot is the way to pass arguments to the dnorm. So we need to know the names of what dnorm can expect. Mean and SD are the two arguments. So I'll say mean equals 15, SD equals 5. Oh, and I'm not supposed to put parentheses here.
right now?
I'm graphing whatever this prior, this curve that I used to set a prior on the standard deviation.
Okay.
I'm putting that. It actually hasn't worked because this it's peaked at zero still. So I don't think it's...
Put it in the...
Okay. Let me look at this warning, see if it's useful. Warnings. SD is not a graphical parameter. Oh. So I thought that curve was going to take this dot, dot, dot and pass it to this expression. But if I scroll down here, I bet you for the function method... Okay, so that's not what it's doing. What I have to do is instead of putting these as extra arguments to curve, I actually have to call the denorm. It's a little weird. I haven't seen this elsewhere in R. I just happen to know that this is how you do it. I'm going to provide multiple arguments to denorm, so I'll put it on new lines. And the first argument is called x. We haven't defined anything called x. Curve is going to handle that. It's a little bit weird. So mean equals 15, SD equals 5. That means I can take this part off here. All right, try that again, and there we go. So for any given function that I give you, I might show it to you using curve. And this just shows like the shape of the distribution. This one reflecting sort of maximum credibility at around 15, tapering off to about certainly it drops to nearly zero at zero.
You say for the math though, when we're assuming standard deviations or graphing them, we use like the Weibull curve to avoid the negative section?
So last day I mentioned that we might use a different thing here. But I decided to not go that far for that day because I didn't have a good sense as to the specific type of Weibull that I would want or the parameter value for the Weibull that I want. We're going to do with that today. For now, this is just a quick way of showing the curves that we'll be using. So another thing I mentioned the other day... there's a bunch of numbers in here that we just like came up with, and I gave you a little bit of justification saying that, okay, this 30, it's kind of on the scale of the variability that we'd expect for the data coming in. So having a amount of certainty, or the standard deviation expressing how certain we are in the location being expressed in terms of like one or two units of the amount of noise that you'd expect in the data makes for a what I would call a weakly informed prior. There's a way to actually formalize that so that we don't have to actually put in the numbers specifically in here, that we can make it so that all we'd actually have to do is have one script that will, I'll put in some dummy numbers and we'll be able to use the same script for all the cases of different types of data with different standard deviations and amounts of noise and things. So to do that, I want to actually go back to my analysis script and introduce a new function to you guys. Not sure why I had this. All right, so I'm going to modify this file because and you guys have a copy in the Dropbox from the last day of what we did last day, so I'm just going to go ahead and pretend we didn't do any of that last day. So delete it all. I guess I still want the library rstand still there. Did I run that yet? Nope. Okay. So I'm going to... the function that I want to do, and in fact, I don't want to use a function yet. I'm going to, last time I had you guys separately compile the model, then sample from the model. I'm going to do that all in one step. I did that before because in the olden days, Stan wasn't smart enough to know not to recompile the model every time. So it made sense to separate those as two different steps. Now it's pretty smart. It will only recompile a model if it sees that you've actually changed the code. Oh, question
Sorry,
over here.
I'm just trying to say, like, in context, what's the goal, right? Are we trying to graph
the goal,
SD versus the anomalous D?
The goal right now is that I'm going to show you how to, I'm not going to use this one. We're going to use the t-test version of things.
Yeah.
And I'm going to make it so that you don't have to know. So we entered 30 here, and we entered 5 here. And that's because we thought about the data, and we decided that those were good values. I'm going to show you what I'd been promising, this sort of default way of doing priors that allows you to not have to think too much about these. So I'm going to create an object called post. That's going to contain the posterior samples from the stan model. And I'm going to call just the rstan stan function. It's going to take two arguments, file equals, in the name of the file, one sample 02.stan, and data equals. So we want to remember, we need to pass stan a list of named objects as its data thing, so list, and it's expecting in something called IQ, so I have to put IQ equals something. Now the thing I gave it before, I said $IQ, and we could do that, and that's just going to run through this same thing that we had before. Instead of passing it IQ, I'm going to modify IQ so that this IQ has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. What does that, does anybody know the statistically colloquial term for that transformation where I subtract the mean and make it so it has a standard deviation of 1?
Yep,
that's one word for it. Z score is another word for it. Standardizing, normalizing, sometimes people say. So, what does that do conceptually, though? So, the first part, subtracting the mean. So, if I say AIQ minus mean AIQ, what does that part do? Yeah. So we can actually even look at the, say, a histogram of AIQ minus mean AIQ. This is one of the histograms from the base package. Sometimes things in base package are faster to plot if you want something really gross looking but fast to create. Okay, so we've gone from, and I can say hist AIQ. We've shifted the distribution from a mean of about 109 to now a mean of precisely 0. That's going to make it so that in our code here, we can say, I no longer want to say that I have a prior distribution where I believe in 100. I want to express a prior distribution with a belief of 0. Now that's actually saying that I believe the population mean should be about equal to my sample mean. If you have a sample mean that's very much, so we've got a sample mean that's 109. That seems like we're now choosing a different prior relative to what we had before, where we had a prior that was peaked at 100. But if you think about these curves, one that's peaked at 100 versus 110, when it has a variability or a standard deviation of 30, those aren't very different. So even though we might express sort of our own true prior as being 100, the difference between 100 and 109 isn't a big deal. So and we noticed also that even when you made this very certain and you put it at 100, it was going to shift to 109 anyway, or towards 109. So a pretty standard thing is to set at least, in this scenario, the mean, your prior for the mean centered on the mean of the sample that you have. That's going to be made particularly uncontroversial by what we're going to do next, which is we take, again, we subtract the mean, but in addition to subtracting the mean, we divide by the standard deviation. And it looked like it's changed the shape. It actually hasn't. It's just changed the number of bins that it's decided to plot and where the binning points make. All that's done is it's rescaled things so that the standard deviation of this of the data is 1. So you can think of these numbers now as reflecting, again, those standard scores, Z scores. So a value of 1 now reflects a value that's 1 standard deviation away from the mean. So if the previous standard deviation, previous mean was 109, previous standard deviation was 13, then a value of 1 would reflect an IQ score that was 122. Yeah.
So I have a question. If we, for example, had the sample come from, say, a bunch of geniuses with IQs of 109, a mean of 130,
mm-hmm.
what would be the ramifications when we just did here?
Well,
in the same standard deviation.
Yeah, it would, again, maybe let me work through what we now do to the prior, now that we've scaled the data so that it has a standard deviation of 1. So having scaled the data so it has a standard deviation of 1, if we now put in this part, ignore the standard deviation, population standard deviation parameter right now, what this prior is saying is that we think that the population mean is about the same, is peaked at the point where we observe the sample mean, but with a standard deviation equal, or like our credibility falls off on either side with a magnitude that's the same as the amount of noise we observe in the sample. So in most scenarios, the amount of noise we observe is much bigger than the magnitude of effects that we observe. You can also think of this in terms of this is a by standardizing the data, we're now in effect size space. So most effect sizes are very small, they're 0.3, et cetera. So this is actually a bit of a weird case to start applying this. I wanted to show it earlier than later. In later cases, it's going to make a lot more sense because we're not actually interested in the population mean that much. We're interested in the difference between two conditions. In this case, if you actually did have data where it was from like a genius group, then yes, this would. So they had like a IQs of 140, 150. This would reflect a prior centered on 140, 150, and with a so that would reflect a prior that's very different from what we had before centered on 100. So you probably wouldn't want to do this trick in that scenario where you it would be rather distorting. In most other scenarios that we're going to be using, this prior wouldn't have that ramification, really.
So you're generating this entirely based off your observed data.
Yeah.
You're just kind of transforming it. It's still like, just even though I don't understand at all like what you're going to do next, but conceptually, if you have weird data in general, like you just happen to get a weird sample.
So yeah.
That just seems like a...
Well, you might get a weird sample in terms of, so again, this is talking about what our belief distribution would be for the mean, and it's scaled to how variable your data is. Maybe you, I guess, you might be concerned, maybe you observe a very errorless sample, or like not a lot of variability in your sample, in which case this would become a prior that's sort of overly highly concentrated around the sample. Yeah, that is a possibility. So you can actually, a very common thing is to also like make sure your data, your analyses are immune to that sort of scenario by rerunning the analyses with even wider priors, so 10, for example. So you are correct in pointing out that there are scenarios that the data, if you make your priors data-driven like this, the data can cause you to choose priors that maybe don't make sense or don't aren't reasonable priors, but that can be troubleshooted by trying it out with multiple reasonably uninformed priors, and usually it works out okay in my experience. All right, so by scaling the data, we can express our prior on the mean of the population in terms of it just being centered on zero with a sort of credibility fall off of one. Similarly, I have to remember I was plotting it up here, but down here is when I'm actually passing the data to SAN. So subtract the mean and divide by the standard deviation there. For the population SD, I no longer want it centered on 15, probably want it centered on, what do you think?
One.
Because again, yeah. And maybe with a standard deviation of one. So that would be a pretty wide norm. Let me actually take a look at what that looks like. So mean of one, standard deviation of one, and run that. So if I've got a mean of one, it's a distribution that's peaked at one. I've told this to be go from 0 to 30. Maybe I'll say 0 to 5. So we see it a little bit better. So it's peaked at 1, falls off on either side. This is where the normal starts to not make so much sense as a zero-bounded distribution, because the normal actually isn't zero-bounded. We're saying, though, that we're going to use the normal with a lower bound of 0. So this is where I tend to use the Weibull distribution. Let me show you. So Weibull of... 2. So the Weibull distribution has two parameters. Just like the normal distribution has two parameters, the normal distribution has two parameters, one of which is the mean, the other is the standard deviation. The Weibull has a shape parameter and the scale parameter. So let's see what the Weibull distribution looks like. Instead of d-norm, it's d-Weibull. And instead of mean, we want shape equals 2. Instead of SD, we want scale equals 1. So if we run that, that's what a Weibull distribution looks like. You can see that it's peaked a little off 1 if we use a shape of 2 and a scale of 1, but it's close enough. And it drops down to 0, which makes sense as like a prior. You don't actually have... You probably have zero credibility in zero noise in your data. So having it there be any mass still at zero or any heights to this curve at zero probably doesn't reflect your true beliefs. So I really like this one as a representation of variability parameters. Question here?
Yeah, it seems imperfect in that there's still credibility for all these high values, but...
Up to about 2, like it's 3, so, and what this actually kind of gets at is, like, you could have observed data, maybe you've observed some data with lower noise than it actually has, than the population has. If you wanted to make that even smaller, you could make this scale smaller, but that would shift the whole distribution even further away from 0, so I've found this one is a...
Safe side, could you say?
It's fairly weakly informed. It's still okay with what we would consider fairly large values for the standard deviation.
As far as the shape and the scale goes, is this something that you just kind of know
what
the shape to
be? Yeah, so I've sat here and played around with different shapes and scales for a long time. So if I put 1.3, make something like that. If I make it 3, makes it something more normal looking. So yeah, I've done some playing.
Details,
sorry?
Sort of.
The Weeble, the shape, closer to 3, actually. I think even if you go even above, it starts being negatively skewed.
Okay. So 3 is kind of essential, depending on how far over you go to each side.
Yeah, exactly. 1 is exponential.
Okay.
So it goes from exponential to increasingly positively skewed.
What happens if you go to like 100 or 1,000?
I think,
like
yeah. Yeah. So I've just sat and played with these shapes.
Okay.
And again, the goal is just to get a shape that kind of reflects what you would sort of what you find credible or surprising. It's not like the analysis is not going to be super sensitive to the precise values you put in here.
So it's not like we should put in, like, if we put 2.2, it'll be pretty much centered over 1 where we have the most credibility.
Yeah. No, it's yep. So this is why I like for a variability parameter like this population SD is in the generative model part, I like to express them as, once I've scaled the data so that they're standardized scores, I like to express them as Weeble, the shape of 2 and a scale of 1. Another one you'll find common is either that normal 0,1 or you'll see Cauchy 0,1. Cauchy is a normal, but Cauchy looks like a normal, but it's. Do you know what I mean when I say a student t distribution? No, let's. I'll actually show you. Instead of d Weeble, we'll say d t. DT, is that a thing? Yeah, I think it is. Let me actually, DT. Yep, student T distribution. If you take the student T distribution and you give it a big DF, say 1,000. excuse me. Let's see. I think that's all it takes. It's the normal distribution. Again, peaked at 0, we're cutting it off at 0. As you reduce the number of degrees of freedom, the tail starts to sort of expand out. So if I say 4, notice the tail is getting a little bit thicker, 2, a little bit thicker, and 1. With degrees of freedom of 1, that's the Cauchy distribution. To contrast that to, again, there's the normal, there's Cauchy, normal, Cauchy, normal. So the tails are a little bit thicker. There's with the Cauchy. That's really commonly used sometimes for variability parameters. We're going to use it for beta regression, beta weights in regression, where we actually do want to express skeptical prior of 0 as the highest belief, but for a variability parameter, I'm not a big fan of that because I don't put that much credibility in 0 as a value. So I use Weeble. Do 1. Now, one further thing we can do to this model that would make it a little bit more robust against, or allow us to use the same code now for different data coming in. So my next project is on some, I don't know, the height of people, not IQ. Well, I could actually change this to not be IQ. Maybe I'll just call it Y. So I'll change that. That would make it just semantically a little bit more generalizable across different experiments. But in that particular experiment, I had 100 observations of whatever it was I was modeling. So I want to make this generalizable. Before I do, there's a question.
Yeah,
sorry, I'm just want to go back briefly to the standard deviation.
Yeah.
So the model for the mean was based off the data. The model for the standard deviation is not. It's just
it's still based off the data in the sense that having scaled the data to have an observed standard deviation of 1, we now can express a curve for the our belief that is peaked around 1, but falls off pretty quickly thereafter.
Okay, and the first after we build that 2 is representing
the shape.
The shape, and the 1 is representing where?
Scale.
Okay, so how do we know it's peaked at 1 is just that shape of Weibull peaks at 1?
Yep. So there it is there.
It's just based on the Weibull shape.
Yeah.
That we're getting that peak.
Yeah, exactly.
Like
peak around 1. It's a little bit less than 1. It's like 0.88 or something that it's actually peaked at. But
it's a bit confusing because like the normal, the first object there is 0, and that's representing the actual peak.
Yeah. Yep.
This is totally different.
Yeah, normal and Weibull, they have those. They have 2 parameters each, but those parameters do different things. Yeah. Yeah. All right. So the last thing we want to do, we changed the name of the thing, the data we're giving it. Instead of IQ, we put it to Y so that it's generalizable across different experiments. The number of data items we're giving it has to change as well. But we can't just like put a question mark there or whatever. We actually have to give the number of elements as another data object. So we have to tell it it's going to be an integer coming in. We're never going to give it decimal place number of items. So let's just call it n. And I have to put a semicolon at the end. So having told it to expect something named n, I can then say and use n to prepare the vector for receiving n items. Does that make sense?
So prior to running this, we would need to define n?
Yeah, exactly. So we would, in our list of items, in addition to giving it IQ, we need to give it something called capital N. And it's just the number of rows in A.
Is there, why can't you just have the N equals N row A within the stan?
Because stan, I'd have to give it A as a data set, and it would still need to know how many rows are in the data set in the first place.
Okay.
So yeah, you have to just, here's the number of rows in A. It's not called IQ anymore. It's expecting something called Y. So we'll put that in. I did a bunch of typing to do this, AIQ. Turns out there's standardization is such a common thing that there's, of course, a built-in function for that. So instead of all that typing, I'm just going to say scale AIQ. Annoyingly, scale by default returns a matrix with as many columns as there are columns in the thing that you wanted scaled. We only have 1 column in the thing that I want scaled, but it's still going to be a matrix of 1 column. So I have to use the square brackets, which I didn't really show you much about because we mostly use dplyr to wrangle things. But square brackets is sort of the older way of subsetting objects like datasets and matrices. So square brackets, comma 1 means grab the first column and turn it into a vector, basically. So it's a little arcane, but this little bit here achieves the same thing as what we had before with this big long bit. Doing it this way just means that you're less likely to screw it up.
So the one is, I'm just making sure, the one is that's telling it to grab the first column. And okay, so if it was comma 2, it would grab the second column and turn it into a vector?
Yep.
Okay.
If there were a second column.
We're actually
just passing it a single vector. So there's only 1 column in the output.
Right, yeah. For this, you would only ever need the 1, but just the other.
And if you went square bracket 1, comma square bracket, it would grab the first row.
Row, yep.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, so my stan file, I'm going to save, make sure it's saved. And this, I should be able to run this, and it's simultaneously going to compile this file into a binary executable that's going to run really quickly. Then it's going to pass this data to that binary executable and tell it to obtain a bunch of samples from the posterior and store the result in this object called post that we'll print out. While that's just going, I'm going to start actually typing out what I would print. I want to print the post object, but if you recall, it often prints more digits than I actually need, so I'm going to say digits equals 2, so only show me 2 significant digits in any of the columns. The other one is that it shows me more percentile points than I actually want, so I'm just going to say only show me the 0.275, and then 0.975 percentiles. And it's actually run through really quickly. Resize and print. And we get output for the mean and the standard deviation. The peak for the mean is at 1. The peak for the standard deviation, peak for the mean is at 0, and the peak for the standard deviation is at 1, which is about what we'd expect given that we scaled the data to have a mean of 1 and the standard deviation of 1. And we can see that the standard deviation for if the credible interval, again, we went into things with a prior with mean of 1 and a standard deviation of, mean of 0, standard deviation of 1, it's reduced by a factor of about 10. So that's, we're really confident in the values between negative 0.2 to positive 0.2. Ditto for the standard deviation. We went in with a Weibull distribution that the scale means that it's about a standard deviation of, it's a little less than 1 if you actually generated data from the Weibull, but it's reduced fairly dramatically so that we're fairly confident in values between 0.88 and 0.16. So if you imagine most of the mass between here. There was a question before.
I have 2 questions now.
Yeah.
The first one, so just up one argument, that post equals rstan in your code.
Right
just,
here.
Yeah, what you did there is just getting it ready to accept the type of numbers that are now going in after our other modifications. Is that right?
Yeah, so last class, I had 2 commands, one that compiled the model and another that sampled the model, gave it the scale, or gave it the data and sampled. This command does it all in one go. It was just less typing.
Okay.
I also kind of realized since last class that the old method that I used to do of compile first, then sample was not necessary anymore, given some improvements.
Got it. And then second question is, what does that tell us? Because it's just sampled and gave us like what we kind of engineered it to give us.
Yeah, well, it's given us, it's not surprising that it's given us these values in the sense that we scaled it and we're just getting back out values that are consistent with those scalings. But we can actually rescale back to the original and see what it actually means for the, what the credible interval is on the original scale of the data itself. So to do that, or how would we go about doing that? Anybody have a guess? Yeah, so if we scaled by subtracting the mean and dividing by the SD, we can actually undo that scaling by multiplying by the SD and then adding in the mean. So let's see if we take this point, the lower bound of the 95% credible interval, multiply it by SDAIQ and add mean AIQ, that will give us a value of about 106. And do that to 112. So our credible interval is now expressed back on the original IQ scale of 106 to 112 for that mean. What would I need to do to get the standard deviation samples to the scale, the original scale? Well, say you multiply by the original standard deviation, and then nothing. You don't need to add in anything because it's just a scaling. So from 11 to, wait, 116, oops. Twelve to 16 is our credible interval for the value of the standard deviation. Now, I mean, these are still centered on what the data values were in the first place. So in the sense that you kind of express that all we've done is we've gotten what came out of the data in the first place, or what we've out what we put in, basically. But that's really what the, if you're using really weakly informed priors, you actually expect to happen, is that the data is going to dominate what you get out of it. The utility of having it scaled so that you can express these is that when you don't have a lot of prior information, the data drive the analysis.
Okay, so for the previous one, we had our assumed model, and it was pretty obvious that the actual mean of the sample was different from the null model.
Well,
we
went in with a prior, and it
prior.
Got shifted quite a bit to get to our posterior. Here, we actually went in explicit with a prior that's fairly consistent in terms of where its peak is with the data. Our prior was still really broad, and whereas our posterior now is nice and narrow. So in both cases, the distribution of belief has narrowed up quite a bit, so we've become more certain about what we believe. In the first case, we shifted away from a posterior, away from prior that was centered at zero. In this case, we haven't needed to shift because our prior actually was already peaked at the data location. The critical thing in these analyses is not like the magnitude of shift or anything. That's not what we're actually measuring. As long as you go in with a prior that's relatively broad, and because this normal 0-1 actually does still encounter that original peak of 100 being our peak prior, is still relatively credible in this alternative prior that we have here, or this second prior that we've started using. So it's still a relatively reasonable prior distribution, and we're still getting out the same result in the sense that it's peaked now at this value that's around 109, and fairly tightly around that value. So if we even went back and we checked what we got out of the original analyses that was peaked at 100 and a standard deviation of 30, the credible interval at the end is probably around the same. So what we've achieved here is we haven't need to think too much about what values we're actually explicitly going to put in here. If you do have a lot of good prior information for what values to put in there, go for it. That's the best thing to do. I was just attempting to show you something that will continue carrying forward, which is when you don't have a lot of good prior information, how to scale the data so that your priors are expressing things in terms of an effect size, signal-noise ratio, such that they're still relatively wide and won't influence the results a lot.
So, yeah, I mean, if you're going to think about making an argument about like an effect based on this posterior, would you say we're pretty sure that just the sample does cluster around this mean?
Yep. And indeed, if we wanted to double check me, when I made the fake data, I used a mean of around 108 making this fake data. So our conclusion that zero is not a credible value for the population from which this data was sampled is actually accurate with respect to how I generated the data. Okay, so let's see. Let me I'm going to leave that. So the one sample case, we're going to jump to a two sample case next, which this sort of default prior is going to make a little bit more sense. We're going to still, though, jump back to the idea of putting in the priors by hand. So let's do that. I'm going to close this. I'm going to save this. I'm going to copy this curve code and put it at the top of the one sample analysis now so that you have that if you want to play with it. Don't save those changes. Close that. All right. So I should be able to close and go to my two samples case. Okay, question?
You were like, we could almost just copy that exact code and put in like a single column of our own data.
Yeah. Yep. Nope. That's the benefit of doing a lot of this by code is that you can, once you've written analysis once and thought about how it might generalize to other experiments, just reuse your code.
Another question as well. How do you make the file be a stan file?
When you go to save it, do save as, and it will, you just put a dot stan at the end.
I did that and then it added a dot r.
Oh.
Yeah. So maybe I didn't. I got
well, try it now. Try
okay.
It.
See how it's got.
Yes. Is it really not believing you? Another way to do it is in your files pane, there is a, a rename. So if you check the file that you just saved and you click rename, it should definitely give you the ability to change what the extension is. Okay, so,
No.
Oh, okay. Okay, so I opened up the R project. It's some fake data. I'm going to start the project by creating a script, immediately saving it. I'll call it two samples.r. Load in tidyverse. Whoops. Library tidyverse. This is a CSV. If we go out and preview it, it's just a two-column CSV. There's an IQ column and a group column. So I'll say A equals reader read CSV, file equals IQ.CSV. And that should read in. If we say view A. We've got, it's read in properly. We've got an IQ column with a bunch of IQs and a group column with, I see, NS and BC. So this is Nova Scotians versus British Columbians. Let's do a quick little histogram. So we'll say pipe A to ggplot. and mapping x equals IQ. Geom histogram. And we'll do it as facet wrap. Actually, facet grid. It's faster to specify something as being done by row. So in as a row, I want group. And I want nothing in a column. Could not find function, blah, blah, blah. Oh, I didn't run the very first line, which is load in tidyverse. All right. So we've got IQ scores from two provinces. There's a bunch of them. So there's like 100 IQs per group. See, they're both kind of centered in the sort of the expected range, a little bit more variability in one than the other, maybe. All right, so what sort of model? Well, we want to think about modeling this. Is, as a first approximation, do we think Gaussian? They both kind of have that nice Gaussian shape, so let's go with Gaussian. I'm going to create a new file. Immediately save it and replace the extension. So I'll say two samples.stan. We'll call it two samples 01 because we're going to do a couple models. Use stan, change. So, data int. We have two groups now, so let's talk about group 1 and group 2. So we'll talk about the number of people in N1 and the vector of data of length N1 for group Y1. And then similarly, we'll have another group 2. So there's some number of people in group 1 and some number of people in group 2, and Y1 is the data for group 1, and Y2 is going to be the data for group 2. We'll have a parameters section, which I'm going to leave empty for now, the model section. What do we want as our model? Maybe get you guys to make suggestions.
Is an effect in there?
Not yet.
Oh, sorry.
As before, a normal distribution centered on zero.
Okay. So let's talk about for Y1. We've got data coming in. Y1. What's Y1 expressed as? So this is one group. We talked about it being normal, having a normal distribution.
So, I mean, for the both the mean, well, normal for the mean. Depends on whether we standard.
Well, we're saying now here, this is the part of the data where we're saying what Y1 is just distributed as. So it's normal. There's, like, if we look at, we're going to call BC Y1. So it seems to be a normal distribution. Do we want to do inference on the center of that distribution? Yes, no? Yes? Okay.
Yeah.
So Y1 mean, we'll call that a parameter we're uncertain about. That means we need to express that here. Okay, so there's something called Y1 mean that we're uncertain about. That means that we actually have to express our prior beliefs about it. Maybe it's a normal distribution centered on 100 with credibility falling off either side of 100 with a rate of standard deviation equals 30.
So we're taking the standardization thing.
We're ignoring standardization so far. What about this variability here? Do we want to be a kind of Z-score idea, which is assume that we're certain about that value, or should we be uncertain about it? What do you guys want to do?
Be uncertain about it.
We want to be uncertain about it? Okay, so we'll call it Y1.
So we're going to be uncertain about that when you assume the mean for the, when you assume that the mean is centered on 100, isn't it? I mean, we're drawing that.
We're not, we're expressing that we're uncertain about the mean of the population. We have a peak credibility at 100.
Yeah.
But we would believe 110, we'd believe 120.
But you're drawing that peak credibility just from the fact that it's an IQ test.
Yep.
And so why would you?
The fact that we have prior information.
Yeah.
So we can do the same thing, be uncertain about the precise value of what the standard deviation is.
Let's put it up as,
but say, okay, real, it's a standard deviation, so we have to say lower equals zero. And similarly, we need to say what we would believe. Can't remember. Actually, I think we can use Weibull shape of 2, but scale of 1 of 10, sorry. Let's actually take a look at that. Down here, curve, expr equals D Weibull, x shape equals 2, scale equals 10, from equals 0, 2 equals 30. Okay, so that peaks at around 10, so let's make this scale go to 15. I don't know. So we'll say from. All right, so that's peaked 15-ish. So maybe we'll say that seem a reasonable distribution for how what you would believe in terms of the standard deviation of the population generating the folks from PC. All right, fairly wide. Like, we still have reasonable credibility down to a standard deviation of like 1 up to values of 30. So fairly wide, uninformed prior. Have to remember my semicolon at the end here. All right. So we're all done with group number 1. We've basically just done the exact same model as we had before for just a single group. And we've applied that model to group 1's data. What would we do to incorporate the idea that there's a second group going on here? Yeah, so everywhere, create copy lines. Everywhere there's a Y1, we can put a Y2. So I'll say there's a Y2 distributed as normal. Y2 mean, Y2 SD. So we need to create Y2 mean. Copy that. We need to create Y2 SD. Copy that. Copy. Copy. Does that look? So for Y1, it's got an uncertain mean, peaked at 100. Y1 has an uncertain standard deviation, peaked at around 15 as we plotted that out. Ditto Y2 has an uncertain mean, peaked at 100. Y2 has an uncertain SD, peaked around what we plotted up before. Now, notice this is actually a little bit different from your typical, what you guys have been shown in typical stats classes, because in this model, these two groups could have different means. And they also could have different standard deviations. We are going to express priors that are the same, but the priors are going to be combined with the data and come out with possibly different values for not only the means, but also possibly the standard deviations. So we have obviated the assumption of homogeneity of variance. I mean, we can impose a homogeneity of variance assumption. How would we do that? We won't even need to do anything as complicated as averaging.
So we just make one variable for standard deviation?
Yeah.
Or for Y.
Yeah, you would just sort of delete this Y2SD1 and maybe just call it SD. There's a function called SD, so I don't know. Underscore it. No, that's not going to work. YSD. So let's say YSD. So YSD is this common standard deviation. But it actually doesn't cost a lot in terms of typing to have two different standard deviations. And it certainly looks by just eyeballing the data that there's probably two standard deviations going on there. So I'm going to put it back to us having two. So you can add that extra restriction if you wanted to, but you don't have to have it. It's going to estimate a common standard deviation. It's going to estimate a model under which both populations have the same standard deviation. If we were to run it through, it'll probably have a value for that standard deviation that's about the average of what the two sample standard deviations are. But that model probably wouldn't fit the data quite as well as one where we actually allow them to differ one to another.
So I understand, I understand that, but like why don't you have to have I understand why that doesn't have to have it because you have got two different things, but theoretically, why don't you have to have this homogeneity?
Well, we are expressing a model for an algorithm for how the data were generated. We're saying the algorithm is it's some sort of normal distribution, and we are only limited to our imagination with regards to, let me actually shoot. We're only limited by our imagination with regards to what algorithm we want to implement and then do inference on. Previously, with the other tools that you've been taught with, that was happening in the background. You were still doing inference on an algorithm, a model for what was happening in the world, but you were limited in what models you were allowed to ask questions about. In that case, of the standard deviations, you were only limited to talking about models that assumed homogeneity of variance, and when you encountered data that violated that assumption, you had to do a whole bunch of extra things to try to get around that.
Okay.
Here, we don't encounter that limitation at all. We can build that flexibility right into our model to accommodate that extra nuance of the scenario, having heterogeneity of variance.
Thanks.
All right. Question down here?
And I guess sort of more of a comment, I like this because even if they had homogeneity of variance, just the fact that you're doing it for each population separately would still just come out.
Yeah, it doesn't actively hurt either.
So is there any reason why you would want to combine it?
Nope. When we get into much more complicated models, you can start to get sort of dramatic expansion of the amount of compute time it'll take to add in more complexity like that. But yeah, even then, probably nothing that we'll encounter. Like with Gislain's data, we did some. Gislain has encountered some scenarios where we've had to make some simplifying assumptions just to make it compute within a week. But for most of the stuff that you guys will be encountering, yeah, we won't need that sort of thing. Okay, so I've got a model set up for the data. It's going to take both sets of data, and it's going to give us inference for what the population means are for both groups and what the population standard deviations are for both groups. All right, so I can create an object to collect those inferences, those samples from the posterior. Say rstan stan file equals to start typing, and I can hit tab as I start typing, and it'll realize I'm looking for a file, so it'll look for file names, so that's the one that I want. Data. What do I need to do to pass it data? What data is that stan file expecting to get?
It wants a vector.
Oh.
Two vectors?
N1 and N2.
Okay, so it wants something called N1. What's N1 supposed to be? Let's take a look. So what's N1 supposed to be?
Number of BCs.
Sorry?
The number of samples.
Number of samples in the BC column. Yeah. How can we do that?
It's not its own column.
Yeah. Yes, you're right. So if we have A, it's just a bunch of observations. So this is another scenario where I've taught you dplyr stuff to count and separate and that sort of thing. We could reshape the data to wide format by using the spread function. I'm not going to do that. The easier way to do things is just to use the old school way of referring to objects and data wrangling. So a dollar IQ refers to the IQ column within the A data frame. And if I want to subset that data, I can use the square brackets. So if I want to subset the IQ column so that it's only those entries for IQ that the value in the group column is equal to BC, I'd say A dollar group equals equals BC. So this is going through, it's checking the values in the group column. If it's BC, it yields a true. If it's not, it yields a false. In which case, using that trues and falses inside the square brackets means that it keeps all the trues and tosses all the falses. And so it's just keeping the IQ values for which group equals BC. So that's not what I want to pass to N1. I just want to pass how many of these things are there. So you can just say length that. So that's what we want to pass for N1. What do we want to pass for Y1?
Same thing.
So just not the length. Everything inside these brackets. Easy enough. For N2 and Y2, I'm just going to copy those two things. Instead of group equals BC, say group equals NS. And I have to rename them N2, Y2. I think that's going to work. Straightforward. Oh. Error at line 1 in the parser. In the code. Data. Click save. I'm going to do check on save, and I'll click save. Oh no, okay. It's syntactically correct. I don't know what I did there. Try again. Okay.
Do you change anything between when I gave you the error and now?
I could hit save, and so there must have been an unsaved change. Somewhere. I actually have no idea what that, because I just did Control Z to see what changes had happened, but I didn't see any. Oh, you know what? I don't think I saved since I created the file, so it didn't have any contents the first time.
So that
That's
would
right.
be why the first line
yeah.
is the problem.
Yes, exactly. Error. Could not find... Whoa. I didn't load Marstan. In fact, I'm going to start putting that right at the top of my scripts, right after tidyverse. Okay, so in theory... Yay! Okay, so we got a bunch of printout. There actually were some warnings in there, too. Let's take a look at those warnings. So after each chain ran, and they ran in serial, it says the following numerical problems occurred indicated the number of times in chain one, something, something, something. You see like there's a count column associated with each of these entries as a problem that happened. If this count is really low, ignore it. That's okay. This happens, I'm not even going to bother going into why it happens. It explicitly says you can ignore the count when this is a low count. And what I mean by low is, like, we've asked for 2,000 samples, and 7 of them had, like, an issue. If, like, a good percentage of them had an issue, so, like, 40, 50, then that's an issue, then that's something to look at. But usually if it's just this... basically what's happened, it actually has tried to evaluate zero for either the Weeble or the normal with the zero constraint. I wish they'd fix the algorithm so that it's smart enough not to encounter that. In any event, we've got some seeming warnings, but we can ignore them.
If you would, I mean, you set the lower bound at zero, if you'd somehow set it at just over zero, would you like not get this?
I think you,
is that like
no,
the
no,
it's
that,
okay.
Yeah.
It's just kind of frustrating to
yeah.
understand. Like,
right, you can see that. If the number in the count column is small, do not ask about this message. It should say, you can ignore this message. But, all right. Okay, so other than those warnings and the timing, we need to use the print to show the output, and we can see for each of the things we had as parameters, we've gotten posterior samples for those things. So for the Y1 mean, it seems to be peaked at about 109. For the Y2 mean, peaked at about 105. 107 to 108 for this one. I put 7.5, haha, instead of 97. I was wondering why they didn't overlap. Okay, so there we go. 107 to 111, 102 to 108. And we've got standard deviations for these, so about 10, about 14. Credible intervals on those values. So what sort of conclusions would you want to draw from these or these values?
Just barely overlap. They do overlap, so
mm-hmm.
I don't know that you can say that they're different. I'm not sure actually.
So what the credible interval is telling you is that based on what you've decided in advance, you're equally credible about all of those values in your interval.
No. This credible interval, if I express it as this 95%, it's 95% of the most credible values for what that mean is fall within this range. There are values in this range that you would want to believe more than others, i.e., probably around this peak point, but 95% of, you can think about it as if a value falls outside that interval, you can probably consider it not to be very credible.
Okay.
can we graph those two things and see
yeah,
what
sure.
extent they overlap and like how much
yep.
credibility?
Stan Hist will plot the credible the samples for each parameter on its own though. So it would be nice to have them actually like on the same scale. To do that, we need to get a little bit more fancy and get the samples from Stan, this object. Don't rely on Stan to do these computations and everything. Let's get our hands on these samples ourselves. Because again, Stan is grabbing samples from the posterior. So in theory, there's a bunch of individual data values that it's visualizing here. And we just want to plot those up ourselves. You know what? Before I show you that, there is a convenience function. What is it called? Not scattergram. In here. Oh, they must have taken it out. There used to be a caterpillar, what's called a caterpillar plot, but it may have shown. We'll just do it by hand because it's more flexible and we'll be able to show something that I want to point out in a moment anyway. All right. So we're going to get the samples from the posterior. So I'll call them, I don't know, samples equals. And we need to, this is a scenario where there's another function. So we're going to use the extract function. But there's another function with that same name, so you really want to put this rstan colon colon. The extract function, we need to tell it what we want to extract from, so it's the object called post. What's the name of this argument? Object. So the first argument is called object, and it wants the thing that contains the posterior samples. And the next argument, actually, that's all the arguments that we need. What is this samples thing that we just returned? You can look in our environment. It's going to be a list. So for each entry that we have here, plus another entry called LP. Each parameter, y1 mean, y2 mean, y1SD, y2SD, plus one called LP. LP is something about the, won't even go into it. It's called log probability, but we won't need to use it. So what I want to do is I want to grab, I guess, the y1 mean samples. Go y1 mean equals samples dollar y1 mean. And we'll grab the y2 mean samples as well. Same way. Now I can do a histogram of y1 mean. That should be that same histogram that we saw. Yeah. We want to combine them and do a nice ggplot with them. So create an object. It's just a data frame. Y1 mean. In fact, I'm not going to store this data frame away. I'm going to create this data frame and immediately pipe it to gather, because here it's y1 mean in one column, y2 mean in the other column. I want them actually to be all in one thing, so I can do a histogram and ggplot and have as two different facets, the two different variables. So we need tidier, gather, and I forget what gather. Oh yeah, gather needs key equals. Actually, so the key names the column that's going to contain the labels y1 mean and y2 mean. So I'll just call that parameter. And value names the column that has the value, so I'll just leave it as that. I'm going to run that just to triple check that it did what I thought it would do, which it seems to be doing. Pipe that to ggplot. X equals this value column that we've created. And it's going to be par. All right. You would want them actually literally overlaid. Yeah, we could do that.
I guess like overlay this in line, it's just the
fill equals par, and I gave you a warning before about this. When you do a histogram and you're mapping, like for example, the color to two different values, the default position for histogram is to stack. We want identity, and so we probably, so that they just overlay instead of stacking on top of one another, and so we probably want alpha, so it's semi-transparent.
There we go.
All right.
I have one quick question about the code you did just before we analyzed
Yeah,
that.
Sure.
You had like y1 mean and y2 mean. Did you also use those in the .stand file previously when we were like talking about, so like those aren't overlapping at all. It's just because like those are talking about two different things, right?
Yep.
They're both labeled y1 mean. It's just a bit.
Sorry? One is called y1 mean and the other is called y2 mean.
Right.
I could have called this like that as long as I propagated that through.
Yeah. I guess I'm just a little concerned that y1 mean in the stand file is pretty different from y1 mean in the dot part file, which you just created to represent the means of the posteriors.
Do you mean, so y1 mean started out with a prior distribution of this, but that got updated given the data to this posterior distribution.
Okay.
So they both started off with the same prior distribution. They both got updated by the data to reflect now these two different, seemingly different posterior distributions.
Okay. Yeah.
So this is sort of reflects what are reasonable values to believe about what the population one mean, BC folks mean is. And this is reasonable values, given the data, to believe about the Nova Scotia folks mean.
So when you say got updated, I'm just like trying to understand what's happening.
Yeah.
Back end or whatever.
Yep.
Are they sharing that term between the R and Stan?
Yeah. So we give Stan the data, and Stan gives us back in this post object the samples from the posterior, including information about what we should believe about y1 mean now and y2 mean now, given the data that we gave it. So we can use this default sort of way of looking at things with print or geomhist to look at those in a very coarse way. If we want to do anything more with those samples, we need to actually extract them explicitly. And then there's a nice little workflow for graphing them.
So just to be clear, because it sounds like what you're asking is whether or not the objects you just created, y1 mean and y2 mean, are going to somehow bleed over into the stand file, right? And is that what you're...
Yeah, way around.
Or the other way around, where it seems like, at least in terms of coding, I know what you mean, yeah, but you could, like, so in other words, like, Mike, you could have called it something else in the R file, and it would achieve the same purpose.
Yeah.
So I can see why you would find that kind of confusing.
So yeah, so if I say BC means, if I call that BC means,
yeah. I just prefer that.
NS means.
So it's the same effect. Like, you can do that and it won't change.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm referring to why, so when I grab samples from the post object, I have to refer to the thing that was referred to in here, but I can rename them anything I want.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, just like, because they're different, I mean, you're operating different programs, so like,
yeah.
But you're just calling them the same thing.
So, just the B.
I also don't like it.
So, NS means, BC means.
And I just so when you run the stan file through, it doesn't create objects in the environment.
No.
Okay.
No. Yeah, it literally has created a separate app on your computer that has run through that app and then has spit out some result that our stan grabs and receives back. So here's the posterior distributions for the means of those two populations. What would you guys try to conclude from this?
So what I want to conclude is that BC people are on average smarter than NS people.
Mm-hmm.
But that it's not an absolute dichotomy. Some NS people are smarter than some BC people.
Well,
I conclude that there's like a high chance that on average they're different, but there is a chance that on average they're the same, represented by like that overlap.
But doesn't this just show us the likelihood of the means? So what we're looking at here is not a graph of the actual IQ, but a graph of the likelihood that the mean of the IQs is within this range. So it's likely that the mean of the BC IQs falls somewhere around 109, whereas the NS means likely falls somewhere around 106, but it's entirely possible that the BC means may fall at like 108, and the NS means fall at like 110.
But that would be
low probability, but it could happen. That's what I get from this.
Yeah.
Is there tell me if this wouldn't even be meaningful at all, a way to quantify the degree of overlap of the two likelihoods?
I'm sure we could come up with one.
Your face tells me that wouldn't really be very useful.
Well,
you can basically just look at.
Yeah, wait a second.
Okay.
I'm going to have you not talk.
You know too much.
So I'm getting the feeling that there's, you guys feel like there's information here that you're having trouble
describing.
And that's because I've set this up to be that way. That is, I've intentionally let you guys build a model that doesn't actually address the question that we're most interested in. So each of these distributions reflect all by itself what are reasonable beliefs about this population's mean, and what are reasonable beliefs about this population's mean. It would be error, it would be folly to attempt to then address the separate question, what should we believe about the difference between these two populations' means. That information is a little bit here, in that like we could talk about some overlap, but there's a much more direct way of asking that question. And what would you, so this may require a little bit of elaboration, but remember this samples object contains the samples from the model with regards to each individual sample is like a guesstimate of what we should believe about each population. So how would we go about talking about the difference between the populations?
So can you take all the guesses about the one mean and subtract all the guesses from the other mean from all those guesses?
Yep.
That's what you should do.
Yeah. One thing I'm going to do just to be careful. Well, actually, I'm going to do it first this way. Okay. So we've got the BC means and the NS means. There's 4,000 of these samples and 4,000 of these samples. So we can just do BC means minus NS means. So I'll say, I'll call this something diff means.
You need to like order them or anything, just the way they came? Isn't it like random sampling?
I'll get to that in a moment. Okay, well actually I'll get to that right now. This, when we extracted the samples, it did something that's slightly annoying, and on the development boards, they've decided that they're gonna change this behavior in the future. It's grabbed the samples, but then it's actually randomly reordered them. No, we won't need to do anything different. This is fine. Sorry. Ignore. So it's randomly reordered the order of the samples, but the first NS mean sample still corresponds to the first BC sample. So it's technically trying to guess at each mean and for the mean for the NS and BC at the same time. So it kind of makes sense for us to want to combine together the NS mean and the BC mean for their first guess, grab the second guess.
Okay. I guess another way to frame this is like, we don't fully understand the whole sampling process. But
yeah.
The boat metaphor that you gave, like testing the depth, is it like testing the depth for both of them at the same time? Or
yeah.
Two different boats going on?
Yeah, it's got two different boats, so we want to ask that like each boat's first guess and the other boat's second guess. The way we've coded this as two different, like we've literally just said, okay, all the Y1 parameters only ever correspond to the Y1 distribution, and therefore it's kind of like, we could have done it as two different models, one model for the Y1, one model for the Y2, and still tried to combine afterwards. That would have been okay. It would have been a lot more typing, but so.
So this is just going to give us a list of like 4,000 numbers.
Yeah. So now we can ask what is the, for example, the distribution of those. So BR equals 100. So here's the distribution of different scores, or differences between the two groups. Zero's down here, it's pretty much off zero. We can ask what the actual, what is the 95% credible interval on this? This is the first time I'll have shown you how to do that quantification by hand. We do quantile. So quantile will compute any arbitrary percentile within the data. So we want the quantile on, I think the first argument is called x. And probs equals 0.025 and 0.975. So there's our 95% credible interval. 0.88 to 0.7. Notably, zero is not in this sort of central 95% mass of credible values. So you might, from there, make the conclusion that zero is not a credible difference between the two populations. So there's a lot of credibility for non-zero values that are positive, reflecting this thing that we saw visually, that this one was shifted with regards to the other. But we actually have an explicit credible interval now on that difference. So this would be how you'd like report that difference.
So is there like an effect size equivalent to that or not?
Well, you'd be, this is talking about the raw IQ scale. So there's a credible interval of 1 to 7 point IQ difference. If you wanted to rescale that to something that your readers would be more familiar with in terms of effect size, You could do that. Here, IQ points would be pretty standard.
Is there a way to figure out what within what credibility limit zero would be?
You could go through and explicitly find like what the percentile corresponds, like where zero falls.
That's
in that.
Yeah.
You could do that and get yourself something p-value like. I'm not going to show you how because it's
like.
Yeah.
So okay, that makes sense.
So the convention is to not report that, but to instead
report. No, yeah, report the the range of values that are most credible.
It's more.
And if you needed to make a decision about like is zero in that range or not, go for it. So mostly it's sufficient to say this is the believable range.
It's more out of curiosity than useful.
Yeah. Yes, what you say is computationally possible.
Okay.
It's not super useful, I'd say. Furrowed brows.
Just trying to like understand a little bit more. So you've got like the credibility for each, and then you just subtract them from each other. So you have like a credibility difference, and then you figured how much like is 95% of that credibility difference.
Yeah.
Cover.
Whatever.
And so like if we look at the graphs, I guess I can't really just subtract those two from each other in my head.
Yeah, it's hard to.
Not like, I mean, the overlap actually looks like it's more than 95%, or more than like the extra 5%. But that's just like visually.
Yeah, I think that's just your brain isn't able to do that subtraction well. Yeah, so this is how you'd go about doing that explicit comparison of these two groups.
What is BR in the HIST function?
Breaks, yeah. Sorry, this is one of those built-in plotting that.
So what does that tell it to do?
Put 100 bins.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
so
it's the number of
bins. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. I wanted a nice, finely binned histogram there.
This data is clearly made up, right?
Yep. Yeah. Yep. And I assigned the labels arbitrarily, and I. Obviously, being from Nova Scotia, didn't intend for this direction.
So, like, let's say the 2.5% was at like -1, and the 97.5% was at like 5 or 6.
Yep.
That
would reflect a scenario where zero remained a credible value for the difference between the populations.
So basically, it has to be above zero for us to be 95% sure that there's a difference.
Ha. That I need to be careful about that. Be 95% sure. You're close in the Bayesian world. You're closer to being able to say that relative to the frequentist world, because you are if you specified your prior to what you genuinely believed, and you follow the rules of probability in updating that, which is what the Bayesian method does, then. Expressions should maintain that, I think what you said, you're 95% sure that something's
so
happened.
Given all our prior
assumptions. Yes, exactly. That should follow. I like to be a little bit more technical when I express it. I say 95% of the most credible values fall in this range.
So how would you report that 95% of the most
credible interval is you just put CRI instead of CI. Yeah. Like it's this idea of the credible interval is sufficiently accepted in the Bayesian world that it wouldn't be weird. Everybody knows what you mean when you put that there.
How would you say if that was like essentially zero isn't.
Yeah, and so usually when you get to your discussion section, you have to start making extrapolations and conclusions that will dichotomize your data in ways that you really wouldn't have needed to in the results section, in which case I'm comfortable having, I typically espouse the rule of, okay, if your credible interval includes zero, zero remains sort of in the central mass of credible values, so it remains a credible possibility. If it's outside the 95, then you can start talking about it as not. Usually, I try to be a little bit more nuanced by talking about, like, in this particular scenario, there's evidence against the null, or that zero isn't very well supported by the current amount of evidence.
But even if zero is in that range, it can be, like, less credible than a lot of the
yes,
other numbers.
Yes, yes, and that's important information.
Yeah.
That's actually one reason why you not only want to report this value, but it's a good idea to have a visualization of the posterior so that you can see sort of where, like, what other values might be much more credible than zero still.
So you could, do people ever say, like, there's 67% of the credibility falls in, like, the positive?
Well, actually, I know the person that is, like, my current guru in the Bayesian world, Andrew Gelman, actually doesn't like 95% credible intervals. He likes 50% credible intervals. More to reflect another property of the models that we're not going to discuss till next week. That is the concept of coverage. But I haven't heard people report a 95, but then also try to report kind of what you're saying is where does the zero fall in that percentile. Usually that's gleaned from just seeing the distribution and having a nice visual of that. There's nicer visuals than this that I'll show you in a bit, called violin plots, that you can show on the various parameters that will be a nice figure to put in your plots or in your reports. Now, we've looked at the difference between the means. Is that the only thing that we might be interested in from this sample in our model? Aha! So we also have standard deviations in the as parameters in the data set. So we could actually ask that question about the heterogeneity of variance that we kind of saw in the data. Should we believe that there's different standard deviations in these two populations? Maybe they're the same, maybe they're different. In traditional methods, you'd have to do certainly a lot of wrangling to get a test or to get any sort of evaluation of that, whether there is equal variability or not. With this, it's as simple as instead of talking about the means, we'll talk about the standard deviations. So I'll grab this. That, paste it below. Everywhere I see means, I'll put SD. Instead of means, SD. SD.
Just use like Control H.
Yeah, there is a replace all, so I could have said mean and SD, and so I'll go replace. There was one I missed. Next. So that's again. Okay. BCSDs and SSDs. Whoop. Do a little plot of the SDs. It does look like one is more believable than the other, but let's do the explicit difference score. Get a histogram on it. Zero seems pretty extreme in this. Indeed, the 95% credible interval. Now, it's negative. That's just because I happen to subtract the smaller one from the bigger one. So if I wanted a nice positive number to report, I would just change that. I would change the histogram and the numbers. So here again, zero is not a very credible value for the difference in standard deviations between these two groups. So we not only can talk about differences in the sort of central location of each group, but also in the variability manifest by each group.
Those are numbers of standard deviations?
This is the standard deviation, the difference in the standard deviation. So one group had one that's more around like 9, Another group had one that's more around like 14, 13.
So are those credible values for the standard deviation? Is
yep.
That what that is?
Yeah. So it seems the two groups not only differ in their location, but also in their variability. So we'll continue with this example next on Wednesday. I'll show you ways, to preview a little bit. We had to do a whole bunch of computation out here because the model didn't talk about the things that we were interested in, i.e. the difference between the two means. I'll show you how to actually make the model talk about the thing we're interested in instead of having to do it outside the model. All right, I'll save this and I'll upload it for you guys.